West Bank, occupied by Israeli troops 40 years ago. This is the most sensitive area in the whole Middle East. 2.5 million Palestinians live alongside 500,000 Israelis. Peace has fallen out of fashion. We'd come to find out why. In a six-day war in 1967, Israel took this land from Jordan and occupied the West Bank of the River Jordan. Now Israel's building a barrier that keeps Israelis and Palestinians apart and stops suicide bombers getting into Israel. The Palestinians say Israel is turning the barrier into a new border, absorbing occupied territory into Israel itself. We're heading towards the Palestinian village of Belin. We've heard there's going to be a demonstration there later today to protest against the construction of the barrier, against the separation wall. As we drove along the line of the barrier, we passed a new Israeli settlement. The Palestinians say these Israeli cities must be removed before there can be peace. This settlement of 35,000 Orthodox Jews is just across the barrier from Berlin. Palestinian demonstrators were gathering, together with foreign activists, in town for a conference. The Israelis have taken our land, they've taken our pride. We have a right to live here. He's glad to see people from different countries, from Canada, from England, from all over the world, coming here to stand by the Palestinians.
Follow me, we want to begin our action.
They began marching towards the barrier. The villagers told us half their land was now on the Israeli side and was going to be used for new housing in the nearby settlement. The land alongside the barrier is a closed military zone. But these Friday protests have been going on for 2 years. We're getting very close to the wall now. The Israeli police, or maybe it's the army, I can't see properly, they've come across the barrier and they're here waiting up ahead on the Palestinian side. They started to fire tear gas. The canisters landed among the crowd. Quickly, there's a canister
right here.
It's been tear gas. There's another one right behind us. Not everyone could run fast enough to get away from the fumes. This was the old man we'd met earlier. The demonstrators regrouped and began to walk through the olive groves to get to the barrier. We're going closer here to a line of police. We seem to... There's a line there and there are more police down there, more Israeli police down there somewhere. Oh, they're firing rubber bullets, okay. The tear gas kept coming. The Palestinian journalist we were working with, Massad Abu Tuama, was trying to keep us out of the line of fire. Okay, the soldiers are coming in now.
Go.
Which way?
This way.
Firing rubber bullets right behind me. So much for... Look at this man.
I realised it was our colleague, Massad.
Oh my God!
He was unconscious. As paramedics from the Palestinian Red Crescent carried Massad on a stretcher, the Israeli soldiers continued their advance. Rubber bullets were flying everywhere. We discovered Massad had been hit on the back by a tear gas cylinder. The force sent him headlong into a pile of rocks. He sustained a serious head injury. 23 others were injured. Israel says the barrier is temporary and can go if a peace deal is agreed. But on the Israeli side of the barrier, there's a building boom. The government's planning tens of thousands of new homes. Even if the wall comes down, these new cities will ensure the land it encloses will remain Israeli. We're heading to Hebron. It's where Abraham, revered by both Muslims and Jews, is said to be buried. Outside the city, we again saw expanding settlements. Israeli watchtowers guarded the roads. The Palestinian Authority is nominally in charge of Hebron. but Israeli troops make frequent incursions to arrest terrorist suspects.
We can hear the music up ahead and the speeches.
Gunmen from the Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigades postured for the cameras. They were protesting against the Israeli raids. Palestinian politicians have also been arrested, further weakening a leadership already crippled by the civil war being fought in Gaza between the Hamas and Fatah factions.
As we're standing here, all these people are jostling up and thrusting these pictures in our faces. Everyone wants to talk to us about their relative who's in jail.
But no one wants to talk about the Palestinians killing each other in Gaza, only fighting the Israelis.
He said, my uncle is definitely not a terrorist. He's a freedom fighter. He's trying to be a liberator of our land. How can a freedom fighter be a terrorist?
In Hebron, 120,000 Palestinians and 700 Israelis live in a segregated city.
This is the Palestinian part. And here, it's impossible to get through for all the barbed wire separating Israeli and Palestinian areas.
We heard some Israeli settlers had just bought a house right in the middle of a Palestinian neighbourhood. They call this place the Shalom House, the House of Peace. When we arrived, they were still moving in. These settlers believe God gave the Jews the right to all of the land in the West Bank. After some discussion, the settler spokesman, David Wilder, decided to invite us in. We're going to go into the House of Peace, as it's known, and David's going to tell us about it and show us who's living here. The settlers use middlemen to buy the house from a Palestinian. It's a capital crime under Palestinian law to sell property to an Israeli. The previous owner is now in a Palestinian jail.
We've done a little bit of work, very, very minor kinds of renovations to put up some walls and like that, just to make it a little bit more comfortable, give people a little bit more privacy.
They live communally.
This is basically a communal kitchen. We have a synagogue here.
Oh, that's a synagogue.
Yeah, and here.
Can I go in?
Yeah, sure. There's nobody here. This is a place where people can study and people can pray.
This is the first house the Israeli settlers have acquired in a Palestinian area of Hebron for 20 years. It's a hugely provocative move. But other settlers from across the West Bank were flocking to show their approval.
You see, this is a group of people that live in Efrat, right in Shetzion. And they came in to see what was happening in Shumbaya, to show a little bit of support and just see. This is where my daughter lives. They brought in some mattresses and crib for the baby and they have a room.
David, this is not the lap of luxury. Why do you do this? Why do you pioneer like this?
People have the dedication. They realize that this is the way things start. This is the way the State of Israel started. And that's why people are willing to live like this.
For ideological reasons.
Of course, for ideological reasons and religious reasons.
Whether the settlers have acted legally is being debated in the Israeli courts. But for the moment, Israeli soldiers guard them. Suddenly, an unexpected visitor arrived. Yossi Berlin, an Israeli politician who wants peace talks with the Palestinians, was coming to hold a press conference.
Can I ask you, why are you coming to the house today?
Well, I oppose any settlement of Jews in Hebron. I think that it is crazy.
Berlin told me that the settlers are an obstacle to peace. The settlers blocked Berlin's path and accused him of selling out to Palestinian terrorists. He was surrounded by heavily armed police to protect him from the settlers. But they still managed to drown him out with their shouting.
This is a very big problem in Israel all the time. There's a lot of division between people who consider themselves to be right-wing and people who consider themselves to be left-wing. Very, very strongly opposed opinions on everything, whether settlements should exist, whether they're legal or not.
The settlers' tactic worked. Berlin gave up on the press conference. The settlers say that Jews should be allowed to live anywhere in this land, that it's racist not to let them.
Only when we have peace.